like you lost another one. Hey, y'all. Hey, happy Monday to you. Welcome, everyone, to Saki Speakeasy podcast, where I speak easily on various topics that cross my mind throughout the day. I'm your host, Saki Speaks, and I appreciate you giving me your most precious commodity, your time. You guys could be anywhere else right now, but you're here spreading the legs on yet another erotic book in the speakeasy with me. Now, I done said erotic, and so y'all know that's gonna make a whole bunch of them doggone bots come in here, but that's all right. Love Jones is in the building. So welcome, you guys. Listen, y'all do me a favor. Show my moderator some love and affection moving in the right direction. She is running around all blue-lipped and out of breath, keeping us safe while we're reading in the speakeasy. So love her up a little bit, please. And while you're at it, make sure you like, share, comment, and go ahead and subscribe to the channel. It's a good time over here. And please make sure you click that notification bell and select all so that each and every time I turn the lights on, kick the doors open, drop the beat, and start mixing those strong evening libations, YouTube will send you a cute little notification telling you to get your ass on over to the speakeasy so you could be a part of the festivities, okay? So listen, before we get into some things, let me tell y'all this. Welcome to all of my new sippers and speakers. Thank you so much for subscribing to my little janky podcast. I appreciate you. and hope you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to my returning sippers and speakers. Thank y'all for all of the love and affection that y'all show me. Y'all, I want y'all to do me a favor. If you have Spotify, and if you don't get Spotify, please get Spotify and go ahead and support our boy, Digi Denny. Okay, he is a faithful sipper and speaker. And the name of his podcast on Spotify is Digi Denny Presents the Walk and Talk Podcast, and it's on Spotify. Okay, so y'all check it out. I enjoyed it. Some of the ladies listened to it as well, and they enjoyed it. Okay. And his first, the one that we listened to today, his latest upload is called Can Sex Work Make the Dream Work? Oh my God, the bots are going to come, child. Listen. But it's all right. So, and it was very good, y'all. It was really very good. I liked it. And Denny has a very soothing voice. I was like, okay, Denny, I see you. All right. But it's really, really good. I enjoyed it. And so did the ladies. Okay. So support him, please. And thank you. And let me do this.
Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money. Money, money, money.
Thank you very, very much, Learning to Love Myself, for the Cash App, darling. Thank you so much. I appreciate you. Thank you. Thank you. All right. So listen, y'all, as you know, we are getting ready to get into Stolen by a Billionaire 2, right? And this book picks up right where the first book left off. So I'm going to read the synopsis to you guys after I say hey to y'all. And then I'm going to skip those first 9 pages because they're literally the end of the last book. And there's no point in me reading that all over again, because if you weren't here for the first book, you don't know what the heck I'm talking about anyway. And if you were here for the first book, you like, why is she reading this? We heard this shit already. All right. So, hey, Love Jones, that's my little quietly learning in the back all day super sniper. Welcome, darling. Happy Monday to you. Thank you so much for being here. Hey, Marva. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Hey, learning. Feel like I've been talking to you all day, girl. Welcome. Thank you for being here, darling. And thank you again for the Cash App. I appreciate you. Welcome. Hey, Kim Bird. Been talking to you all day, too, girl. Welcome, welcome. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Let me see. I'm scrolling. I think I got... Hey, Vicky Black. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for sliding into the Speakeasy and being here with us. I appreciate you. Look who here. Choco Chip. Choco Chip is here, y'all. And guess what? She brought the good vibes with her. Yes, God. Thank you for being here, lovey. Happy Monday to you. Welcome, welcome. I think... Uh-oh. Listen, I knew this child wasn't going to miss it. Hey, Kim Cash, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome. She like, If you laugh, I'm here. All right. Thank you so much for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. So listen, y'all, let's get into this thing. Okay. Let me read the synopsis to you. This is Stolen by a Billionaire 2. The synopsis reads, everyone around me kept trying to tell me that what I felt for Ananias Duke wasn't real, but I knew in my heart that it was. But did he feel the same? And if he did, could we actually survive with everyone we love against us? Okay. So again, like I said, we get those first 10 pages, or technically 9 pages, that were the end of the last book. And then once I get to page 10, we'll get started. All right. So here we go. Y'all know I like to start at the top of the minute. So I hope everybody had a great Monday. You know, y'all ready for some libations and a little bit of naughtiness. All right. Because y'all know Miss J give it up in these books, okay? We love to hear it. I love to read it and y'all love to listen, okay? All right, we 8 seconds. 5, 3. Urvi. Pow. When the gun went off, I jumped back. Duke's eyes widened before stumbling back a couple of steps. Blood started spilling down his neck, and staining the collar of his shirt. My eyes widened before everything started to move in slow motion. The only thing I heard was the rumbling of the thunder through the sky and the rain slapping against the concrete. The gun slowly slipped from Duke's hand before he slapped his hand against his neck. Blood poured through his fingers. My mouth opened, but I couldn't scream. Or was I screaming, and the roaring in my ears drowned it out? Duke used his other hand to help himself down onto the step. My mouth opened, but nothing came out as I positioned myself in front of him, pressing both of my small hands against his neck. His mouth was moving, but I couldn't hear anything. Looking up at the door, Amos, Dominique, and Duke's grandfather had run outside. All their mouths were moving, but I couldn't hear anything. Amos reached into his waist and pulled his gun out. Another flash of lightning whipped across the sky just as the muzzle flashed on Amos's gun. The burning sensation ripped through my arm, making my brain catch up with the rest of my body. Suddenly, my hearing came back. I was screaming at the top of my lungs, matching Dominique's scream. Pow! Another burning sensation ripped through my shoulder, jolting me back. No! Urvi, go! Leave now! Duke shouted and tried to stand up. Pow! The sudden burning sensation in my ear sent a shock through my whole body, making me fall to my knees. I kept trying to reach out to him, but he kept shouting for me to leave. When I was getting ready to stand back up, Amos had placed the barrel of his gun to my head. Amos, no, it's just a... Duke started. Bitch, I've been waiting for this moment for the last few weeks. Amos, Duke yelled. I closed my eyes while praying in my head. Click, the gun jammed. Click, the gun jammed again. Urvi, go now. He didn't have to tell me twice. I got up and started running down his driveway, completely ignoring the pain surging through my body. The only thing keeping me upright was the adrenaline flowing through my body. I ran as fast as I could until I got to the gate, which was already open. Once I was at the end of the road, the adrenaline started to wear off and my heart pounded inside of my chest. Clutching my arm, blood continued to pour out of it. I started to jog down the road as much as I could. I jogged, but what had to be at least a half mile before everything started to become blurry. This is where it ends for me. My low eyes widened just a little bit when a pair of lights turned on the road. Stumbling out in the middle of the street, everything went blurry before fading to black. Ah, child, listen. Amos done shot the girl, what, three times? Two in the shoulder and one at the ear? All because she accidentally... Oh, my God. Yes, I had a good weekend. I did, Marva. Thank you. Yes, I had a good weekend. I had a great Monday. It's been storming here, but yes, it's been great. Hey, Royal Lily. Good evening, darling. Welcome, love. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. All right, let me get back to this now. My eyes popped open and bright lights were shining in my face. My body was moving fast as hell. My chest was on fire. It hurt to look around. It hurt to move my head. Looking forward, I saw that there was a woman sitting on top of my stomach. Mrs. Warren, you're back with us. My name is Dr. Esther, and I'll be treating you today. Can you tell me what happened to you? It hurts. It hurts. Please, it hurts. There was clicking and flashes from cameras. I know, Mrs. Warren, and we're going to get you something for the pain. You have so much blood on you. Where are you hurting? Tell me where you're hurting. Inhaling hurt. Get those goddamn cameras out of my emergency room now. Trauma 2 is open, Dr. Esther, someone said in the distance. Exhaling hurt. Mrs. Warren, we're going to get you fixed up, okay? Don't worry. Transfer on my count. 1, 2, and 3. I was moved from one bright light to another. Everything started turning black. There were so many voices. There were so many shadows above me. Mrs. Warren, stay with me. Stay with me. Where you been, huh? The whole world has been looking for you. I'm glad you're back with us. Stay with me. Stay with me. I blinked. My arm, my head. Help me. She's losing too much blood. Figure out where that blood is coming from. Hang 2 units of O-neg right now. The room started to fade to black. She's crashing. She's crashing. She's... Many hours later. My eyes were so heavy when I tried to pry them open. There were several shadows in the room. I blinked a few times to clear my vision. My father paced in front of my bed. Looking across the room, I saw that Kamani stood in the window with his back to me. My mother sat across the other side of the room, staring into space. When I tried to shift in the bed, a pain shot down my arm. Ow! My dad rushed to my side. Baby girl. Oh, my God, baby girl. He placed kisses all over my face like I was his little 7-year-old girl again and had just finished my Easter speech. He gripped my face and stared into my eyes. Baby girl, I knew you were alive. I knew you were alive. Water welled up in his eyes before the tears slipped down his face. Oh, Dad, I whispered. When I tried to lift my arm to wipe his tears away, it stung to high hell. Don't try to move. You were shot several times. I closed my eyes, remembering the jolt that sent my body backward, and immediately opened them. Stop smothering the damn girl, Miko, my mother said from her seat. He moved back a little but stayed at my side. Mom, come. She stood up, walking over to me, shaking as she walked. The rims of her eyes were redder than my father's. Her body shook involuntarily. Mom, I called out to her. She hasn't had a drink since the night you were kidnapped. Fasting and praying is what she said. She's in withdrawal, my dad whispered in my ear. When she finally made it to the bed, she gripped the rail and walked toward me. A small smile crossed her face before she folded her lips. She gripped the rail so tight that her knuckles started to turn white. Val, I, her shoulders slumped. Mom, it's okay. She fell over me and started sobbing. I groaned as the weight of her body started to crush me. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. I thought I knew. I don't know. I didn't think that I would get to see you again. I never thought that I would get to apologize to you for being a bad mom. Mom, I breathed out. Katrina, you hurting her. Move. When my mom lifted herself off me, I instantly felt better. Looking past my parents, I saw that Kamani still stood at the window staring out of it. My dad looked at him and then back at me. Kamani, my dad called out to him, but he didn't turn around. The door came open, and the doctor I vaguely remembered walked in with a smile on her face. Mrs. Warren, you remember me? I'm Dr. Esther, she said while walking over to me. Kinda. Yes, I was working on you when you came in. Do you remember what happened to you? She flashed a pin light in my eyes a couple of times before checking my IV. I was shot. Yes, three times. Shoulder, arm, a really deep graze on your ear. You're a very lucky woman. I hope you know that. All the bullets went through and through, which was the reason you lost a lot of blood, but also the reason why you'll be able to heal just a little faster. There was no major damage, no bullet fragments inside of you. Yes, you're very lucky. How's the pain? About a 5 or 6. I would like to sit up. Okay, we're going to get you something for the pain. Here's the remote that controls the bed. She placed the remote in my hand and showed me how to work it. The nurse will be right back, she said before leaving the room. Pressing the button on the remote, I eased up until I was comfortable. Kamani was still over by the window, hadn't even turned and looked at me. My father looked at his back and then at me. There were a few knocks on the door before it came open. The man I knew from the TV as Agent Dean walked into the room in a plaid gray suit with his badge hanging around his neck. My chest started to feel a little heavy because I knew all the questions that he wanted to ask me and I wasn't sure I was ready to answer. Shit, I didn't even have the answers to the questions I had. Good afternoon, Mrs. Warren. My name is Agent Dean. I was assigned to your case and not now, Agent Dean. She just woke up. Mrs. Warren, is it okay if we have a conversation? Yes. Kamani turned around. No. I looked at him and he eyed me. If you need time to get your story straight, say that. What does that mean, Agent? Kamani hissed. Agent Dean, she just woke up. Give her some time to let the medicine wear all the way off. When she's ready to talk, you'll be the first person that we call, my dad said. He smiled at me before nodding his head. When he left, my dad hugged me and kissed me again on my forehead. We're going to let you have some alone time with your husband. We'll be right outside. Your brother, sister, and Christina might want to come in. Is it okay to send them back? Yes, please. My mom and dad showered me with kisses before they headed out of the room. As soon as the door closed, Kamani walked slowly over to me. What happened between you and Duke? What are you talking about? He reached into his pocket and snatched a plastic bag out of it. He threw it on my chest. Looking at it, I saw Duke's gold chains in the bag that I took off his neck in the garden and also the necklace with my birthstone on it. He pissed off because he know, oh, you got that man's chain on, with both of his chains on, and he done bought you a necklace. You done gave up a little cootie cat. What's up? Kamani been fucking everybody whose name starts with an A and a Z and every alphabet in between. And he got the nerve to ask her a question about what happened between her and Duke. None of your fucking business. Don't worry about all that. Anyway, child. I'm going to ask you again. He leaned over the bed and got nose to nose with me. What the fuck happened between you and Duke? You fucked him, didn't you? You got some motherfucking nerve, Kamani. If you want that nose on your face, you better get it out of mine before I bite it the fuck off, I hissed. Who the fuck are you talking to, Val? You. Man, Al, the door flew open and Christina rushed in and stopped when she noticed Kamani and I were having a stare down. She walked slowly over to the bed. Everything okay? Kamani pecked my lips before moving out of my face and snatching the bag of jewelry off me. Christina eyed him and squinted before rushing over to me and hugging me. Ow, shit, I'm sorry, Val. Which arm is it? My left side. Come over to the other side of the bed. I wanted her to block my view of Kamani because I couldn't stand to see his face. The nerve of him to try and question me when he been laying up with only God knows who. Val, you don't fucking know how much I missed you. Oh my God, I didn't even know I could cry that much. Almost cried down the crack of a man's ass last week while I was finishing up his back tattoo. We burst out laughing. Ouch, it freaking hurts to laugh, man. She hugged me again before pulling back and looking at me. You look different. I've been shot. 3 times, might I add. I might be able to put street bitch on my resume, you heard me? We burst out laughing again. Come on, he scoffed across the room, making Christina scoff even louder. I slightly shook my head at her so she'd let him be a negative Nathan by himself. The door came open again and my eyes widened when Dr. Wallace walked in. The expression on her face was very unreadable. The closer she got to the bed, the harder my chest felt like it was about to constrict. When she pulled the needle out of her pocket, I flinched. Val, you okay? You scared of needles now? My throat started to tighten as if a strong man had 2 hands wrapped around my neck. Child, you act like that's a bad thing. Anyway, everything is going to be okay, Mrs. Warren, Dr. Wallace said. The pain is going to go away soon. I couldn't read the expression on her face. I wasn't sure what she was trying to tell me. Could it be a warning to keep my mouth shut? Could it be that Duke sent her to check on me? My mind was all over the place, and since I'd woken up, I hadn't had a minute to even think for myself. Shit, is Duke dead? Was she here to avenge his death? Everything is okay, Mrs. Warren. The pain will be going away soon. If you need anything, you can call me. She smiled before winking at me. The nerves finally subsided when she left the room. She could have been playing a game with me for all I knew. You know her? No, I spit out quickly. No, I don't know her. She squinted before biting her lip. That girl knew me better than anyone, even better than Kamani, so she could spot when I was telling a lie. She also wasn't going to push the issue in front of Kamani. Before she could say anything, the door opened, and my little sister and brother came into the room. Big sis, God damn, you look bad. Thank you, Ulysses. You're welcome. He leaned over and hugged me. That was how our relationship was most of the time. We always joked with each other, no matter the situation. Being funny was his coping mechanism, so while he made jokes, the rims of his eyes told a different story. Uriah leaned over and placed kisses on my cheeks. Don't mind him. You look pretty, especially for someone who's been kidnapped for the last month. I didn't know what I was going to see when I walked in here, she smiled. Uriah was extremely pretty and smart. She was better than I was at her age. She literally kept her head in them books and not on them niggas. She made me proud to be her big sister every time I looked at her. She was completely different from me and our brother. She didn't party at all. You had your mother going into withdrawal for you. If I had known you getting kidnapped would have stopped her from drinking, I would have arranged that a long time ago, Ulysses said, making me laugh. Ouch, don't make me laugh. It hurts to laugh. Whatever Dr. Wallace gave me made the pain subside a lot, but it still hurt to laugh. What y'all doing tonight? It's Friday. I'm about to use your kidnapping as a means to get into parties for free. Ulysses, me and Christina said at the same time, making him laugh. He shrugged his shoulders. Oh, well, I'm just saying. You know how much sympathy pussy I've been getting? My lips slipped apart trying to hold my laugh. Really? Yes. I'd hit and cry, hit and cry, hit and cry, cry and hit, cry and hit. Her brother ain't shit, y'all. He said sympathy pussy. Lord have mercy. Him gripping the rails of my bed, fake stroking while wiping his eyes, brought tears to my eye. I was trying so hard not to laugh. Uriah's face was scrunched up. You are literally the most disgusting person I know. Ulysses shrugged his shoulders. There were a couple of knocks on the door before it came open for me to see Mitch and his wife Morgan come in the room. Hey, sis, I just stopped by to show my face, Mitch said. I gave him a fake smile. After learning what I learned about Kamani, I knew that Mitch knew everything about Kamani's ass. Him and Kamani were buddies, so I couldn't expect him to tell me what Kamani was out in the streets doing, but it was him being fake for me. He didn't even have to come visit me. Morgan waved, and I smiled at her, too. She and I weren't cool like that. Of course, every now and then we'd meet up for a double date, but that was as far as our relationship went. We had each other's numbers, but they were hardly ever used. Thank y'all for coming. When Mitch and Morgan left, Kamani left the room behind them. Suddenly, I started to feel tired and yawned. You tired? Christina asked me. Yeah, kinda. Well, we'll be out. You know Mom and Daddy ain't leaving, but I'll tell them you about to go to sleep. Thanks, bro. Both Ulysses and Uriah left the room, leaving me and Christina alone. Okay, bitch, we are alone. Where the fuck you been? And why the fuck do you look so good to have been kidnapped? Is this some shit that Kamani and that bitch Patrice cooked up? I shook my head. I really am tired. I promise I'll tell you everything because I am going to stay with you when I get out of here. Her eyes widened. Really? Yes. Kamani just... Girl, it's too much. Just know he's a bigger piece of shit than you think he is. I was so damn blind. My eyes started getting heavy. Tell me about it. Well, I'll sit here until you wake up again. I don't have any appointments on the books today or tomorrow. I'll cancel for the next few days. You're so sweet. Thank you, Chris. She kissed my forehead before walking across the room and sitting down. I picked up the remote and laid the bed back so I could be a little more comfortable. You want the light on or off? You can turn it off. The light from that window is enough. I stared at the ceiling and thought about Ananias. I couldn't believe I shot him. Seeing the blood roll down his neck, staining his white shirt really stunned me. It was like I was there, but I wasn't. I could see perfectly, but I couldn't hear anything. When that first gunshot hit me, it was like I fell out of a time warp or something. I'd done a lot of shit in my life, but being that close to death was the scariest shit in my life. Amos was going to kill me. He wanted to kill me. If his gun hadn't jammed, he would have blown my brains right out. I hated that after all of that, overhearing the conversation with his grandfather, Amos telling me the Duke would only love one woman, getting shot by his brother, still felt like a small part of me would be missing without Duke. Honestly, I missed him already. Was I already exhibiting symptoms of Stockholm Syndrome? Maybe. Him saving me from his brother meant something. He sat up on purpose, trying to protect me from his maniac brother. That had to count for something, right? That's the end of that chapter. I don't know. What y'all think? I don't know, y'all. I'm wondering what the hell, and who picked her up and took her to the hospital? That's what I want to know. Who picked her up, took her to the hospital? And how did the cameras, well, I guess everybody knew once she got to the hospital who she was, because hello, she's the governor's wife and everybody was looking for her. Listen, Linda, this book, I'm trying to think how long is we going to have to wait until we get the sexy smexy, because listen, she got to heal up and shit and all of that. All right, we're going to wait and see, right? Ananias. I'd been sitting in the same spot for the last 6 hours, rolling my stress balls around in my hand. In my office, glued to CNN, watching the cameras stand outside the hospital where Urvi was at. This spot was where Dr. Wallace cauterized, cleaned, and stitched up the wound on my neck. With the amount of adrenaline flowing through my body, I didn't need any anesthetic. She wanted me to take pills for the pain that I was going to be in, but I knew they would put me to sleep. I didn't want sleep. Dr. Wallace was so worried about me that she told me that she'd go to the hospital to see what she could find out. That was over an hour ago, and I hadn't heard from her. They were keeping everything on the hush, and she had security around her room. I trusted Dr. Wallace with my life, obviously, so I knew that she would come with some information, eventually. But I wasn't going to be able to sleep until I knew what the fuck was going on. I'd seen a lot of people shot before, but the way Irby's body jolted back from those bullets made me sick to my fucking stomach. I knew the moment that my gun went off, Amos would see nothing but red and start blasting. It was the reason that I'd set up, because I knew if there was a chance that he'd hit me, he wouldn't shoot. That didn't stop Amos's ass, though. When he placed that gun to her head, my life flashed before my eyes. I couldn't remember the last time I prayed, but I prayed really quick. I tried to tell Amos that it was just a graze, but he was focused on taking Irvi's life. When his gun jammed, I knew that it was fate because his gun had never jammed. One of the main rules our father gave us was to always make sure our guns were straight. Amos cleaned and checked his guns every 2 days, all of them. So for that gun to jam like that, I knew that shit was fake. His gun jammed twice, and his eyes got so big they almost popped out of his head because he was just as shocked as I was. When Irvi took off running, he held the gun up and shot it, and it shot. He was getting ready to run after her, but I grabbed him, and that's when him and Paul helped me in the house. There were a couple of knocks on the door. Not now, Amos, I shouted. I was pissed, too fucking pissed. Pissed at Amos, pissed at Paul. One, I watched the cameras back in my house to see that Amos forced himself into the bathroom where Urvi was, filling her head with bullshit. He had access to my cameras as well, so of course he knew all the shit that I'd been telling Urvi. None of that was true, by the way. I was feeling Urvi, and I didn't want her to leave, but maybe it was for the best. Shit, at this point, even if she was alive, she wouldn't want to have anything else to do with me after what my brother did to her. I was pissed at Paul because he had some fucking nerve to come in my home and demand that I kill Urvi. He took his gun off his side, cocked it, and tried to hand it to me. That's when I heard Urvi at the door. The door came open. What the fuck did I... Oh, Dom, what's up? She eased in the door and shut it behind her. What you got for me? Don't talk to me about fucking Amos right now. She bit the corner of her lip and my face softened a little. Dom, what? Her eyes filled with water. No, don't fucking tell me that shit, Dom. What the fuck? She shook her head slightly. I stood up so fast, knocking the chair back. Dominique, say something. Tears slipped from her eyes before she came around the desk and wrapped her arms around me, sobbing into my chest. I wrapped my arms around her and kissed the top of her head. I hadn't seen her like this since she was a little girl when I came in the house after being gone for like a month. She jumped in my arms and made me promise not to leave her again. Aw, Dom, come on now. I'm okay. You didn't see the blood pouring from your neck. I thought I was gonna lose you. Duke, I can't lose you. I know you're like my brother, but you are really like my dad. You helped raise me. To see you like that hurt me so bad. I just don't know what I'll do without you, she continued to sob. I let her cry in my arms for a few minutes before she pulled away from me and leaned against the desk. She looked at the TV to see that it was on CNN. Have they said something yet? No. I'm waiting on Dr. Wallace to call me with some news or something. This shit is fucking with me. I sat back down. You came in here crying and shit. I thought you were getting ready to tell me that Urvi had died or something. Girl, you scared me. So you really like her, don't you? I do. You think she'll come back after Amos nearly shot her arm off? Dom, I really wish I knew. You know how she is. She might not come back. And then what are you going to do? You going to give up? Should I? We didn't exactly have a stellar beginning, but you didn't see her face when she talked about you. Or when I told her that she was the only one who'd been around the house. She loves you. I think it's going to take a lot to get her back. I looked up at her. Money? That's not an issue. She rolled her eyes. You really think Urvi cares about your money? No, and that is frustrating in itself. She wants things that I'm seriously incapable of giving her. Maybe she'll be better off without me. And she's better with Kamani? I don't feel comfortable talking about this with you, little lady. You are just 25. Urvi is 29. I laugh. Shit, I am robbing the cradle. She laughed. No, you're not. If she was 19, I'd have to pull you aside. Anyway, I'll leave you be. I just needed to come in here and get that cry out. You know your brother downstairs pacing angrily. He's mad you won't talk to him. Why are you torturing him like that? You know how he is. He wants to protect you. I don't need him protecting me. I protect him from others and from his damn self. I'll talk to him when I'm ready to talk to him. When she was getting ready to speak, my phone buzzed against the desk. Snatching it up, I read Dr. Wallace's name on the screen. What the fuck am I getting excited for? And I'm reading. I immediately answered and placed her on speaker for Dom's nosy ass. Dr. Wallace, hey, Ananias, all is well. She's in recovery. Her room is swarming with security and her family is here tightly. When she saw me, she looked scared until I told her that if she needed anything, to call me. I let out a sigh. It felt like I was able to breathe just a little better. And how are you feeling? Have you taken your pain meds? Have you eaten? Have you been to sleep? I think I can eat now, and I'll take them. I won't promise I'll get any rest, but I'll try. Do you promise? I promise, Mom. All right, I'm headed home. If you need anything, do not call me, especially if you haven't done everything I asked you to do. We laughed. Bye, Dr. Wallace. I ended the call. You feel better? Yes, I feel like a small weight has been lifted, but we still have something else bigger that's looming over us. Her eyes widened. Urvi will not talk. You can't think she will. My brother shot her multiple times. She overheard Paul telling me to kill her. She literally has no reason not to tell. They're going to keep pushing her and pushing her until she cracks. Give Urvi credit. She's stronger than she looks. Plus, she loves you. Before I could say anything else, the door came open and Amos rushed in, prompting me to stand up. You are up here ignoring me like a bitch, and I saved your goddamn life. If I had to do it again, I would do it. Blood was rushing from your neck. You should be fucking thanking me, not ignoring me. Amos hated to be ignored. It allowed him to stew in his thoughts longer than he liked. His thoughts were almost always dangerous. More than that, he hated to be ignored by me. Like Dominique, he looked at me as a father figure in his life because I was 10 years older than him, and when Catherine left, I had to stay home with him most times. It allowed us to bond more. He was like a child. He didn't care if I was mad at him. He just wanted me to talk to him. Child, listen, I know a whole lot of folks like that, but anyway. Amos. When I walked around the desk, Dom tried to grab me, but I snatched out of her grip and got in his face. Him and I were the same height, so we were toe-to-toe. He was breathing hard as fuck, trying to keep himself calm. Do you realize that this is your fault? How? Lower your fucking voice when you talk to me, Amos. I'm 2 seconds from putting my pistol to your fucking head so you can see how Urvi felt. I heard him swallow. I pressed the tip of my finger into his nose. You had no fucking right to come into my home and threaten my guest. Filling her head with bullshit. You don't have access to my cameras to spy on me. I have access to your cameras to keep you safe, Duke. Keep me safe? He took a step back. Yes, and that bitch is not safe for you. I don't give a damn how you feel about it. You were risking everything for that broad, and if you hadn't stepped in, I would have still had the situation under control. The reason why we were out there tussling over the motherfucking gun was because you and your grandfather thought it was okay to come over here and spout lies to her. You've never picked out other jewelry for other women. I've never told another woman not to leave my home. I am not in love with Naomi. You are the reason I'm sitting up here with 20 stitches in my neck. Not Urvi, you. When he opened his mouth to respond, I held my hand up. I don't want to fucking hear shit from you, Amos. Not right now. I turned and walked away from him. You letting a bitch come in between us? Spinning around, I got back in his face, nose to nose. Mr. Duke, Dom called my name. Men, separate now. My dad had come into my office with Pa on his heels. Ananias Duke, the third, take 2 steps back. Amos Duke, take 2 steps back. We stared at each other for a few seconds before we both took 2 steps away from each other. I don't want to hear shit from you either, Pa. I really want everybody out of here, honestly. I'm not apologizing for doing what's right for you, grandson. That girl was turning you into someone reckless. I didn't build this name for you to let some woman come in and ruin it all. Business first, pussy second. I suppose that's why Grandma left you, because business was always first. Boy, my grandfather walked toward me, but my dad grabbed him. Where do you get off talking to me that way? You wouldn't have none of this shit if it wasn't for me. I bled so you could have this. I was tortured so you could have this. You don't get to speak to me this way. And while I am eternally grateful for your sacrifices, Paul, you don't get to speak to me the way you're speaking to me now. And the way that you were speaking to me earlier, I know what I'm doing. I've been immersed in this since before puberty. You and your grandson made it y'all's business to come in here and threaten a girl that I like and threaten me. My dad held his hand up. Wait, what? He looked from Amos to Pa. Oh, they didn't tell you the story? My dad looked from Pa back to Amos. They said the young lady went crazy and shot you. Really? Dad, what did you do? Amos, what did you do? I walked back around my desk and took a seat. I waved my hand out toward Amos for him to speak. I turned around toward the window because I didn't want to look at either of them. I may or may not have accosted her in the bathroom and told her that my brother don't give a damn about her. And Paul said, I can speak for myself, and you, son, are not my father. I'm yours. You don't ask me to explain myself to you like I'm a child. That's true, but Duke is my son, and you're not going to threaten him. Am I understood by the both of you? They didn't say anything, but I assume they nodded their heads. Let me have the room, please. Dominique pressed her hand on my shoulder before leaving the office. When the door closed, my father walked around the desk and leaned against the windowsill. Son, are you okay? Physically, yes. This graze ain't shit. Mentally, I kept quiet. If she speaks, you know. She won't. Are you sure? She loves me. She won't. I trust her. You don't know her. I eyed him. I know her well enough. Just because you're fucked doesn't mean she won't tell the FBI who kidnapped her. Dad, please, okay? If she speaks, I'll kill her myself. So you like her? A lot. I'm trying to deal with that. Deal with the possibility that she might not ever talk to me again. Like I was telling Dom earlier, it might be best that we just stay away from each other. I feel like I became too wrapped up in her too fast. It's almost scary how fast it happened. I don't know. I'll be good. Take a few days. Get yourself together. We'll pick up right here in a few days. Is that cool? Yeah. Get some rest before Dr. Wallace has my head. I chuckled. All right. And don't ignore your brother too long. You know how he gets. You know I'm not. All right. See you later. When my dad left my office, I lay back in my seat and closed my eyes. I'd seen a lot of people shot in my lifetime, but to see Irvi's body leaking with blood would probably haunt me for a little while. Even while she was shot, she was still trying to press her little hands against my wound. She couldn't even process that she'd only grazed me because she kept screaming. I could tell that she was in shock. Her little ass probably hadn't even held a gun before. Ironically, I wasn't even mad at her for shooting me, but I was pissed at her for not letting me explain myself. Hell, I was still in a state of shock from her telling me she loved me without saying it. That damn woman was going to be the death of me, and she didn't even know it. And that's the end of that chapter. Listen, Linda. All right, so Love Jones said, wasn't the car approaching before she passed out? Maybe the lady that stopped either took her or called for help. I don't know. I think that she started running, and when she passed out, or right before she passed out, she saw the car approaching. I don't know that it was approaching when she ran out of the gate, because didn't she say she ran like a half a mile or something? So I don't think the car was coming yet. I don't know. Child, listen. All I know is I want her to hurry up and leave Kamani and get back to Duke so we can hear about the fucking and sucking. All the rest of this extra shit, I don't care, right? I don't care about his relationship with his brother, his daddy, his grandpa. I don't care about Kamani. I don't care about her parents. I like Christina, her best friend, but the rest of that shit miss me with all that. I needed to give what's supposed to have been gave. We came here for the fucking and sucking, right? Isn't that why we showed up? That's why all of y'all are here. Y'all want to hear about the fucking and sucking, right? The ushy gushy of it all. I mean, like, what the hell? They could just make a book with all sex scenes, and we would all be so happy over here in the Speakeasy. Everybody would be all love and light tomorrow. Act like I'm lying. Y'all be killing me trying to make like it's only me to be into the freaky deaky. Y'all ain't shit, boy. I'm telling you. Love Jones, block everybody, then block yourself, and I'm gonna shut the lights off, okay? I'm gonna shut the lights off. Soon as you block yourself, I'm gonna shut the lights off and the Speakeasy gonna be closed. Good. Googly moogly. All right, let's get into this next section here, because these don't have chapter numbers, child. All right, here we go. Kamani, 3 days later. I'd been pacing in front of Val's hospital room while Agent Dean was in there talking to her. He put me out of the room to speak with her alone. I wish that I could hear what was being said because I was nervous as fuck. We'd been in this bitch 3 days and barely had any time alone. I doubt if she really wanted to be alone with me since I confronted her about the expensive-ass necklaces that were around her neck when she was brought in. I knew they were expensive because I managed to slip away and get them appraised, just to find out that the two gold chains were worth nearly $40,000 each. The one with her birthstone on it was worth over $100,000. The gold chains had the initials AD inscribed in them, so I kept them. But I definitely sold that necklace and managed to get $80,000 for it. That was the only thing I had to smile about. This motherfucker. Oh, my God. Are you serious? I know, right? I know all of y'all so well. She talking about her freezer works overtime. Yes, God, right? Got to keep that glass dildo and got to keep it cold, nice and cold. Listen, let me get back to the book. Hush. Governor Warren, I looked up to see Dr. Esther coming toward me. Yes, is everything okay? Yes, I just wanted to talk to you privately. Okay. I peeked in the room to see Urvi was now sitting on the bed with her legs crossed, staring into Agent Dean's face. The way he was smiling at her made me uneasy. Neither of their expressions were readable. On cue, they both looked at the door, and I moved out of the way. My office is just around the corner, she told me. I followed her around the corner and into her office. She closed the door and kicked off her shoes. She walked around her desk and sat down. How are you holding up? I'm okay. I'm just happy that she's home. Well, not home, but you know what I mean. Have a seat, Governor. I eased in the seat in front of her desk. You know, while she was out, we did the sexual assault exam that you gave us permission to do. Yeah, was she? I held my breath, waiting for the answer. The only bruises or scars on her were the one on her forehead. It looked as if she could have had stitches just a few weeks ago. There was THC in her system. I saw that scar, and I hadn't had a chance to ask her about it. When I met Val, all she and her friend did was smoke, but I nipped that in the bud. I hated the smell of any type of smoke. I didn't give a damn about the THC in her system. I wanted to know if she fucked Duke or not. That was the only thing that had been on my mind. Okay, was she raped, doctor? Just tell me. Her face softened. There was sperm inside of her. However, she paused and twisted her lips up. Maybe therapy would be best for her. I can give you a list of therapists that are great for this type of thing. What were you going to say? You weren't going to say that. Give me the real. This is my wife that we're talking about. We examined down there, and there wasn't any bruises or abrasions that suggest rape. I don't understand. At the time of penetration, she was aroused. I'm not saying she wasn't raped. I'm just saying that I don't see anything that suggests rape down there. She grabbed her notepad and pen and started writing on it. This guy is really good with trauma and... So, you're saying my wife willingly fucked? Governor Warren, all I'm saying is that I don't see anything that suggests it. All her tests came back negative. We gave her the HIV cocktail just in case she was raped. She'll need to check with her primary care doctor in 4 weeks, and then 6 months, and then a year. I'm telling you all of this, but we're also going to put it in the discharge paperwork. No, leave that out of the discharge paperwork. Her eyebrows furrowed together. We have to. I also took some of the sperm that was inside of her so we can test it. I'm sure it would be very helpful to the police. No, don't. That would embarrass my wife if it got out to the public. I'm sure she's in there telling Agent Dean everything that she knows. I'm sure she doesn't want to relive the rape. Just leave the whole rape kit out of the report. She didn't even tell me she was raped, which means that she's embarrassed. I really hope that you can understand where I'm coming from. I can understand where you're coming from. She tore off the paper and handed it to me. Jason Riley, 404. 555-6734. He's really good, and he'll help Mrs. Warren get her life back on track. Thank you. I'll make her appointment first thing in the morning. She nodded her head, and I rushed out of her office. With the amount of rage running through my body, I could punch a hole in a wall. When I turned the corner, I ran directly into Mitch. You good, bro? Val straight? Yeah, let's go talk in the truck. I don't trust anyone around here right this minute. Walking outside, I ignored the many flashes of cameras and reporters asking me questions. She fucked him, I shouted the minute we were sitting comfortably in the back of the truck. What? Who? Val fucked Duke. The fucking doctor told me that they found sperm inside of her. There were no abrasions or whatever the fuck she said. She fucked Duke. I can't fucking believe that shit, man. Damn. You are tripping right now. That doesn't mean she wasn't raped. If he treated her bad, she'll tell Dean and... He didn't fucking treat her bad. That bitch had THC in her system and damn near $200,000 around her neck when she was brought in. They were fucking. Fuck. Mitch let out a low whistle. I mean, if they did fuck, what are you gonna do about it? I glared at him. The fuck you mean? What am I gonna do about it? It means what it means. You fucked up and borrowed from one of the most powerful men in the whole damn world, and he kidnapped your wife because you tried to get over. I told you that you need to stop playing with people before you end up dead or in jail, but you don't listen. You think you know every fucking thing. If they did fuck, you ain't gonna do shit but pay him his money and either move forward or divorce Val. You've done your fair share of, nigga, please, you want me to divorce her so you can finally get your chance, huh? Mitch looked out the window. You tripping, dog? Nah, I ain't tripping. You been wanting Val from the beginning. I gotta give it up. You don't have to take up for her every time. Just admit it. There is nothing to admit. And who's to say that I haven't already had a chance and succeeded? What? Hit me up when you ain't on one. Mitch got out of the truck before I could say anything else to him. Fuck, man. Back in the hospital, Agent Dean stood outside Val's door talking to his partner. When he noticed me, he smiled that stupid-ass smile. He started clapping slowly as I approached him. What? You got a tough little lady, Governor Warren. She didn't crack. I believe you two pulled off the best scam. Just know I'll be re-questioning you and her down at the station. I held my wrists out waiting for him to cuff me, but he didn't. Thought so. Excuse me. Walking in the room, I closed the door and locked it. When I turned around, Val was sitting on the edge of the bed. She was getting discharged. Her arm was all stitched up and in a sling. The doctor kept reiterating how lucky she was that she didn't die or lose her damn arm from how much blood she lost. She hadn't said more than a few words to me since I threw those necklaces on her. She'd been focusing on Christina, who hadn't left since she came. She finally left early this morning to go do a tattoo, promising to come back. I sat in the chair across the room, glaring at her. She knew I was staring a hole in the side of her head. Why did you lie? Why don't you tell the truth? She spat back. I know you fucked Duke. She glared at me. I know you fucked Haley. I stood up and walked over to her, getting in between her legs. You don't know shit. Who told you that? Your boyfriend? She scooted back on the bed so she didn't have to look up at me. He ain't have to tell me shit. I watched every last one of the few press conferences you did and that fucking act that you put on. Kamani Warren, you have no fucking friends besides Mitch. So why on earth would you be meeting Mitch at a hotel unless you have something else you need to tell me? Like him and Mitch. I opened my mouth to respond, but she kept right on going, pissing me off even more. You have some nerve to be questioning me about anything you think I've done. The way you were fucking around on me and getting bitches pregnant. Pregnant. Fucking pregnant, Kamani. I don't even ask you about a baby no more because you wanted to wait. Look at God looking out for me. A nigga ain't giving you over $200,000 worth of jewelry if he ain't fucking. And what were you giving Haley? That money-hungry bitch ain't laying down and spreading it wide for a broke nigga like you. What you give her? Some of the money you owe Ananias? You probably wish that he'd killed me. Get out of my face. I want a divorce, and you'll be free to fuck any bitch you want and get whoever you want to get pregnant and beg, borrow, and steal from the next woman. I'll be staying with Christina until we get things figured out. I smiled. Ananias, huh? Y'all on a first-name basis, huh? Whatever, she waved me off. Nah, it ain't no whatever, and you ain't staying with that bitch either. You think I'ma let you go that easy, huh? Let you go live over there with that bitch so you can be free to fuck. He is pissed. He done fucked everybody, including her best friend, and now not her best friend, her business partner. And now now he wanna keep her. I can, it's the audacity for me. Excuse me. So you can be free to fuck that nigga whenever you want to? Bitch, please. You're going to keep your ass in my house until I am done with you. You about to see another side of me, Val, and you're not going to like it. Keep it up. She looked taken aback as I cocked my head to the side. Bitch. Bitch. Bitch, please. That's the way you're going to talk to me? Me? She pointed at her chest. Me. Me. Me, Kamani? You're going to talk to me that way after I saved your sorry ass campaign? Me. After I saved your sorry ass life? Me. You out of your fucking mind to think that you can call me a bitch after you fucked every Tanisha, Johnisha, and Haley Isha, gotten women pregnant? Nah, you won't be talking to me that way. She stood up, moving out of the way, and walked across the room. You know what? She turned around and looked at me. The first time I felt anything for Ananias, I was so mad at myself. Mad at my fucking self for betraying you. I hadn't cheated on you, and I wasn't going to start. I just knew that my husband, who I'd pledged my life to, would come and save me. After I went into my savings to save my husband's life, I knew that he was going to give up that money without question. I just knew that he wouldn't try to be the smartest motherfucker in the room, almost costing me my life. I just knew. She chuckled before shaking her head. And that's why, at this very moment, I am so glad that I fucked Ananias. Wrong, too. The fuck you say? Say it again. I heard her loud and clear. I just wanted her to say it again and to my face. I walked towards her. It was the way he let me ride his dick and choke him at the same time. Oh, my God. It's the way he took his time knowing my body. The way he fucked my face. The way he made me squirt. He took that stream on the fucking chest. You hear me? Squirted like a broken fire hydrant. You wouldn't know anything about that, would you? I smirked. And then the fact that you thought you were my first, you were definitely not my first or second, running around bragging about you being my first like it was a badge of honor. Suddenly, that what Mitch said came back to my mind. And before I could stop myself, I raised my hand and backhanded Val to the floor. She fell on the damaged arm and yelped out in pain. She writhed in pain while palming her face with her free hand. I glared down at her. Urvi, let me tell you something. I squatted down next to her and dragged my fingers down her face. She wore a look that I'd never seen on her face. Gone was the strong Val I knew. I hold your life in my hands, okay? Do you know that I could tell anybody to write a recommendation saying that you are too far gone in shock and have you committed to a psych ward? I'll have you so doped up that you don't even remember your fucking name. So here's what you're going to do. You're going to tell your dyke bitch of a friend that the friendship is over. You're going to leave this hospital with me and act like you're so fucking happy to be home. You are going to never run your mouth about who had you. Every move you make will be at my discretion. If you have to use the bathroom, I need to know about it. If you even think about leaving, Urvi, I swear. I paused. Let's just say I know how to make it look like a suicide. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? She kept quiet. My mama didn't lie when she said a bitch like you might need to get hit in the mouth a few times to remind you who the fuck wears the pants in this marriage. Her eyes widened. The door handle jiggled before several knocks came. I helped her to her feet and she snatched away from me. You heard what the fuck I said. She didn't say anything. The knocks on the door became louder. When I saw that it was Christina at the door, I sighed. As soon as I unlocked the door, she snatched the door open and rushed in. Why the fucking door was locked? Urvi, I'm gonna pull the car around the back so you can avoid the cameras. No. I prepared a statement for Kamani and Urvi to make outside, Patrice said, walking in the room. Ain't no statement. She's coming home with me. Patrice gasped and looked at me, and I looked at Urvi with my eyebrow raised. She didn't say anything as the tears slipped down her face. That was the same look she gave me right after I told her that it was best that she quit working. Val, me and Christina called her name at the same time. Christina looked at me and then back at Val. Did he say something to you? She shook her head. I'm going home with him. I'll give you a call or text when I get a new phone. Are you sure? Yeah, I'm sure. Christina gripped her face and wiped her tears away before kissing her on both of her cheeks. She rolled her eyes at me and Patrice before leaving the hospital room. The moment Christina left the room, Urvi glared at me before smiling. Patrice, your client just smacked me to the floor, injuring my arm. Kamani, the only statement that I'll make today would be the fact that my husband owes Ananias Duke money, and the money he owes him is nowhere near $20 million. Bitch, I hissed. Kamani, you owe the Duke money, and he has a gambling problem out of this world. So if you put me in front of a mic, that is exactly what I'm going to say, verbatim. Patrice looked at me with her eyes so wide that I thought they would pop out of her head. So I am going to page my doctor, get my discharge papers. Whoever is going to roll me to the truck while his bitch ass does whatever it is he pays you to make him do. After I'm in the truck, Eddie is going to drive me to wherever Christina is, and that will be the end of that. Urvi. Patrice sighed. She looked at me and smiled. And don't you ever put your fucking hands on me again, Kamani, because you got the right bitch and wrong bitch at the same time. You don't put no fear in my heart. I was quiet because she got me. We both shared a wicked smile. I was down, but I wasn't out. Fear didn't work, so now I had to go back to the drawing board. Hours later, I was rolling Val down the hallway slowly as the nurses and doctors gave her a standing ovation. After what we just went through in her hospital room, it was hard to keep a reassuring smile on my face. Patrice told me to keep walking, not fast enough to make it seem like we wanted to get out of the hospital, and not slow enough for people to be able to stop and talk. When Patrice pulled me out of the room, she was furious at me. It took everything in her power not to shout at me and put everybody in our business. She had to alter the speech that she wanted me to give. She told me that she was going to ask for a raise because I was the worst client that she had. She made sure to tell me that without Urvi, my next campaign was as good as gone. She told me that I needed to make nice if I wanted to continue a career in politics. When we made it to the waiting room, our parents and siblings came out to greet us. She whispered in her dad's ear and he looked at me. I didn't know what she said because his expression was unreadable. When we made it outside, the reporters engulfed us like a mob. Miko grabbed the handles of the wheelchair and kept rolling her down the entranceway. The reporters looked from me to her. Some people followed her and some stayed with me. Patrice warned me that it might happen, but to keep a straight face. The reporters started firing off question after question, but I kept a smile on my face and held my hands up to quiet them. Georgia, it's a great day today. The day that I have been praying for 20 plus days is finally here. My wife, your first lady, is heading home. We've been through such a tough ordeal, and while we would love to share with you every detail, my wife wants to heal privately. What I can tell you is that her doctors expect her to make a full recovery. We ask that you respect our privacy at this time. Thank you. Governor, has Mrs. Warren spoken to the FBI? Do the FBI have a lead suspect in the case? Was the ransom paid? When are you going back to work? I ignored all of their questions as I walked to the truck with Patrice at my side. I opened the door for her, and she slid in the middle, and I slid in after her. Does your father know that you'll be staying at Christina's? Patrice asked Urvi. Haven't told him yet. Didn't want him to beat Kamani's face in on TV. Look at me, once again saving his career and reputation. So we're off to Christina's, Eddie asked. Yes. No. Val and I said at the same time. I'll get out and walk, Eddie. Val, think about this, I said. She looked at me. It's already thought about. The way you physically and mentally abused me not even 3 hours ago, you've got some nerve. Urvi, if you leave now, it makes things look funky. People will start asking questions that neither of you are going to want to answer, which could possibly lead to jail time for the both of you. I'm not telling you to go home right now because Kamani is a piece of shit. However, I am asking you to think about it. After you do a couple of interviews together, we'll break you two up peacefully and amicably. And I'm just supposed to suffer in that house with him? You're working in his best interest, not me. A woman, someone who just told you she was abused. You two don't have to talk. You two could do whatever you want with God knows who. Just keep it on the low. This could help you in the long run. Think about it. She didn't respond. She looked out the window and stayed that way until Eddie pulled in front of Christina's house. I can open the door myself, Val shouted at Eddie when he opened his door. As far as I'm concerned, each of you can go to fucking hell. Patrice, Eddie, you knew that my husband was running around with my business partner and God knows who else, and you both sat up here and smiled in my fucking face. Eddie, I can understand. Patrice, I'm very disappointed. Don't call me or text me. Do not try to contact me or I'll be on Instagram Live spilling everything I know about you. She slammed the door so hard that the glass shook. Looking out of the window, Christine had opened the door with a shocked look on her face. When the door closed, Eddie pulled off. I started punching the back of the seat. Fuck, 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 fuck. That's how you need to be punching yourself in the damn head. Can't keep your dick in your pants. Can't stop gambling. I told your dumbass that I am like your doctor. You can't keep secrets from me. I can't help you when you keep secrets. I'll get her back. I have one last plan. Kamani, enough with the fucking plans. Every plan that you've had has fallen through the cracks, leaving you and everyone around you, including me, exposed. You need to focus on trying to get your wife back in line, because if she doesn't come home and no interviews happen, the public is going to completely turn on you, and all you'll have left is those misogynistic-ass niggas on your side. And that ain't going to win you no election. Not here in Georgia. By the time the public is done with you, you'll be living in a small city in the corner of Mississippi, never to be heard from again. Mm-mm-mm-mm-mm. Patrice, calm down. I promise to be cool from here on out. I got one last plan. I promise, I said while holding my hand up. I smiled as I thought about the plan I'd conjured up. It was going to take a small bit of manipulation, but at least she'd be home with me where she belonged. I'm so sick of this fucking dude. All right. That's the end of that chapter. Listen, y'all. I just want Ananias to find a way to get in touch with her so she can go to him, because I feel like, ugh. Yeah, and child, he ain't no man. That's a little ass boy. Child, listen. Yeah. I'm so sick of him. They can dish it, but they can't take it. Child, listen. At this point, I'm over it. Listen, I want Ananias' ass to just come on. Yes, right. Call Ananias. He will have his ass just ran over in the middle of the street. Oh, my God. All right. I've been up here, what, an hour and 4 minutes? Okay. This is going pretty quick, y'all. All right. Let me see. When is she going to call Ananias? I need her to just... All right. Hold on, y'all. Let me see something here. Can I tell y'all something right quick? Y'all know what I hate? When people contact you on Instagram, don't say shit and just share a dumbass reel with you. They don't say, hey, Saki, how you doing? They just drop a fucking reel in your inbox and keep going. And then they may not say nothing again for like a month. It's like annoying. It's like, what are you sharing a reel with me for? I don't give a fuck about reels. Stop sending me that shit. Now, I don't mind if we cool, you know what I'm saying? If we laugh together, whatever. Or if you come into the speakeasy, drop in the chat, chop it up with me a little bit. That's cool. That's different. I've had some contact with you. But when people just, oh, and I ain't seen you since Cat Williams was a kitten. And he a big old grown ass, old ass cat now. And you want to sit your ass up and send me a go to hell. Anyway, stop sending me reels. Say hello. Hey, Saki, how are you? How's the husband? How's your son? You know, how are the bushes in front of your house? Something. All right, let me get into this next chat, child. I don't know. People are annoying. Oh, is that how they stay connected? By sending a reel? No, you stay connected by dropping in the chat and asking me how I'm doing. We chop it up a little bit. You know, kick the Willy Bobo. I don't even care if you drop in there and say, hey, Saki, just wanted to let you know I'm constipated. I'd have been like, oh, man, Metamucil, you know, something. Take a probiotic, whatever. But to just drop a reel, no God. Urvi, the next day. My senses woke up to the smell of bacon before my eyes popped open. At first, I thought that I was back at Duke's house, making me sit up in the bed as fast as the pain would allow me. Looking around, I was quickly reminded that I was at my best friend's house. Knock, knock, Christina said outside the door before pushing it open. You awake, babe? Yeah, I'm up, girl. The smell of that bacon reminded me, I said and paused. The silver tray she carried in her hand reminded me of Duke's silver tray that was brought to my room every morning, noon, and evening. Reminded you of what? Nothing, she raised her eyebrow. All right, bitch, I let you hobble in here yesterday, take your little medicine, and sleep all day and night. Not today, bitch. You are going to spill while you're eating this breakfast I cooked for you. I know you were sick of eating that hospital food and whatever you were eating when you were kidnapped. Not exactly, I mumbled. Her eyes widened. What did you say? Nothing, girl. Everything looks good. Listen, she ain't even told her friend the what's what. While I was eating, she stared at me. What, girl? Spill. You know who kidnapped you. Ananias. Duke? I nodded my head. And I'm ashamed to say that I kind of miss him. Oh, no, baby. You don't miss him. That's that Stockholm talking. This man kidnapped you. He didn't treat me bad, Chris. You have to believe me. I stayed in a locked guest room. His chef, Steven, cooked all my favorite foods every time. He took me to Indonesia. We played golf together. He took me for a ride on his helicopter. He even let me work out in his gym. Christina started shaking her head. Wait, wait, wait. I don't understand. So, were you really kidnapped? I nodded my head. Yes, I was drugged and woke up in a bed. I pointed to the scar on my forehead. I banged my head against the table in the room and gave myself a concussion. I realized then that I watched too much damn TV. I was like, yeah, you're either going to wake up dead or wake up in the hospital. My dumbass woke up in the room next door. I had several stitches in my forehead. We laughed. I'm laughing, but I'm still confused. You feel like you like him because he did nice things for you while you were with him? I looked down at the tray, twirling the eggs around with my fork. She stood up in a haste. Oh, no. God, no. Val, you didn't. You fucked him? I looked up at her. You don't understand. When he told me that Kamani came to him for money to get rid of a girl that he'd gotten pregnant and you let a man fuck you because he dirty macked your husband? You don't even know if it's true or not. He would have said anything to get in your pretty ass panties. Tears welled up in my eyes. It was nothing like that, I promise. She eased back down on the bed. So explain it to me, everything. I want to figure out where you coming from. I know it's early, but you might want to get a drink. No, I need to be sober. Promise you won't ask any questions until I'm done talking because you'll throw me off and I'll forget where I'm at. Okay, okay. She scooted back on the bed and sat cross-legged. It reminded me of how we'd be when we spent the night at each other's houses, sitting up, gossiping all night when we weren't sneaking out. She picked up a coffee that was on the tray and sipped it. Sorry, girl. So, Let me explain. It took me damn near 2 hours to tell her about everything from the time I was kidnapped, re-explaining how I ruined my forehead, and how I damn near bit a hole in Duke's hand. The way she looked at me when I told her what happened in Indonesia when he almost drowned me almost made me laugh. Of course, I could laugh now. She wanted detail by detail of our first kiss and the first time we had sex. By the time I finished telling her about the garden and helicopter ride, she was giving me googly eyes like she liked them just as much as I liked them. I stopped the story with him eating my pussy and him coming on himself after I called him daddy. Wow, that's something. So I have one question and only question. And I think she meant, and one question only. You could have been home, like he literally left the door unlocked and you didn't leave, you stayed? I nodded my head. That's how I know that I really like him, Chris. She shook her head. You were conditioned to stay in that room, Val. You don't like him. Of course you would start liking him if he was all you'd seen for weeks, and with him dicking you down better than you'd ever been dicked, it would make sense. Plus, you were hurting because you found out that your husband was a piece of shit. All of that circulating in your brain, it was easy for you to spread your legs for him. Are you calling me easy? She grabbed my hands. No, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that you were traumatized into liking someone. Do you think that he's thinking of you right now? I shrugged my shoulders. I honestly don't know. He didn't want me to leave. Ananias is a lot of things, but I just don't think he's a liar. Okay. So I know someone who knows someone, and I want you to talk to them. He's a really good trauma therapist. His name is Jason Riley. Chris, I am fine. No, I just want you to talk to him. You've been through a lot. This man you're saying that you like and claims he like you back shot you, even, and I didn't say that Duke shot me. Wait, who shot you then? Can we go to the AT&T store? I need to get another phone, and I need to go to the banks and get new cards. Okay, we can do all that, but who shot you? Duke's brother, Amos. Oh my God, I already don't like him. I'm gonna kill him. Wait. This story has so many moving parts. Why the fuck did Amos shoot you? I'm trying to take you slow because it does have so many parts. I'll tell you in the car. I really, really need to get a phone. And you need to help me get dressed in one of your little tiny ass shirt dresses. I don't want to raise my arm up for shit. Got you. You. What? Christina looked at me while weaving in and out of traffic. Keep your eyes on the road. You said that you wouldn't react that way. Please. You just said that you shot Duke. I did, but by accident. And you think that man would like you after you shot him? Are you serious? He saved me from getting killed. He told me to run. I did. Okay. So, how you get a gun? I looked out the window at the tall buildings and wondered if he was thinking of me. It had been 4 days and I missed him like crazy. What did I miss his dick? Either way, I missed him a great deal. Well, he was eating me out. Lord, he had me riding his damn face, telling me that he'd been thinking about eating me out that whole day. I'd never been so wet in my life. He wanted me to squirt on his face. Anyway, his grandfather and brother interrupted us and asked to speak to him. In the middle of me getting dressed, his brother accosted me, telling me the Duke didn't like me. I was just pussy to him and more bullshit like that. And you don't believe his brother? No, I don't. I was going to and confront Duke, but I overheard him and his grandfather going back and forth about him ruining the name that he worked so hard for being with me. He then told Duke that if he didn't care about me, that he should come and shoot me in my head. When I heard the gun cock, I ran outside. Duke came after me and asked me what I was going to say to the FBI. I thought he was following me to tell me to stay, but he only wanted to know what I was going to say to the fucking FBI. That shit hurt, honestly. I grabbed his gun from his waist and we tussled over it before it went off. He held his neck as the blood poured from it. You shot him in the neck? Is he even still alive? I mean, we would have heard something, you think? Yes, we would have heard, but you were really just going to stay with him if he had asked you to stay? You were just never going to come home? You were just going to leave me? Of course not, Chris. I looked out the window. He made me feel things. I really, really like him. Anyway, so Amos shot you after you shot his brother? Yep. That's how it went. He always walking around alone. I'm gonna run up on him next time. No, you are not. I don't want to bring attention to it or Duke. So I take it that you're not gonna tell the FBI that it was Duke that kidnapped you. What did you say to the FBI anyway? And that's why you're staying at my house? This is so much to process. Fuck. That's why I'm just trying to tell you in parts. If I told you all this shit at the same time, we would still be in the room having a staring contest. I did not tell them. I didn't say anything for real. I'm staying at your house because Kamani got crazy with me at the hospital, girl. Girl, he told me that he knew I was fucking Duke because of the jewelry that was around my neck when I came to the hospital. He smacked me down like he was Ike Turner, making me fall on my arm. I'm surprised I didn't bust any stitches. She slammed on brakes and the car came to a screeching halt in the middle of the road. The horns honked loudly around us. She turned and looked at me with wide eyes. Why the fuck did you do that? Why the fuck didn't you tell me that little midget hurt you? We would have gone over there and whooped his little ass. Oh, I am so mad. Then why the hell did you send me the hell away? We would have beat his ass in the hospital room. She continued driving. I didn't want to cause a scene in the hospital. I knew that the reporters would have been looking for anything to report about. I'm sure those nurses can't wait to sell some of my medical report information to the media for a quick buck. People are grimy, man. She shook her head. I knew that she was pissed at me and had a good reason to be. We were quiet until we pulled into the parking lot of the AT&T store. She killed the engine and looked at me. Look, Val, I'm really worried about you. I would like for you to make an appointment to see Jason and just talk. You've really been through something traumatic, and you need to talk to someone else who's qualified to help you through this. And while I don't want to pile more on you, I did catch Haley and Kamani coming out of the room together. It took everything in me not to blow the spot up. I should have. But you know I would have never embarrassed you like that. I rolled my eyes. Haley is going to get what's coming to her, but I don't want to talk about her, though. They are both pieces of shit, and honestly, they deserve each other. Anyway, I'll make the appointment to see your stupid little therapist friend. We got out of the car and went inside the store. The store was pretty much empty, so I was able to get serviced immediately. While I sat at the table, Christina went over to the iPads. So how can I help you, Mrs. Warren? The tech asked. I need to get a new iPhone added to my account. He tapped on his iPad a few times. All right, Mrs. Warren, I think we have this phone in the back. If not, I'll bring out more options. Okay, thank you. He walked away from the table into the back. While I stared at the wall, my mind slipped back to Duke. If he wanted me dead, then I'm sure I'd be dead by now. A familiar smell engulfed me before I heard the motions of the seat next to me. Mrs. Warren, how are you doing? I continued to stare at the wall. Agent Dean, you following me now? Ah, she speaks. I looked at him and gave him a fake smile. He was referring to my staying silent when he was trying to talk to me in the hospital. The only answers he got from me were shakes or nods of the head, or maybe a shrug of the shoulders. I wasn't interested in anything he was saying. He kept asking me if I knew who had me and who shot me. He even tried to build rapport, but I wasn't interested in that either. So, it has come to my attention that you're not recovering at your mansion. What's going on there? I started turning in my seat. Mrs. Warren, we're talking as friends. I only have one friend. Off the record, you do know that at some point you and I are going to have a conversation by force or by choice. She ain't got to tell him shit. I turned around and looked at him. There's nothing to tell. There's not? I shook my head. All right, Mrs. Warren, I have your 10 Pro Max right here. The charge will be added to your bill. Is that okay? That's fine. He started scanning the box. Mrs. Warren, where have you been for the last few weeks? I turned and looked at him. Is this the last case before you retire or something? I'm back home, and that's pretty much all that matters, right? He gave me a smile. I like you. I really like you. I rolled my eyes at him before turning back and looking at the tech. I'll be seeing you, Mrs. Warren. Sure. When he left, I felt like I could breathe a little easier. Christina immediately came over when Agent Dean left the store. Girl, is he following you? Probably. Who cares? You should care. What the fuck? All right, Mrs. Warren. Everything is squared away. You're good to go. If you need anything, give me a call. Thanks a bunch. Back in the car, both me and Christine were quiet. I was sure that she had a lot on her mind, just like me. You can take me to my dad's. I'll Uber or Lyft back to your place. Do you have an appointment or something? Yeah, I do. It's a big tattoo, so it might take me an hour or two. So take your time. If not, come to the shop. I'm not comfortable with you being alone. I laughed. I'm not a kid. I can take care of myself. Not with one arm, you can't. Okay. I'll make sure to text you before. You better. You know you hard-headed. I promise. Listen, Linda. I knocked on the door a few times before pushing it open. My dad looked surprised to see me as he waved me in. As usual, he was on the phone talking business. Yeah, Walt, I'll have the order done. My daughter just walked in. I'll call you back. When he hung up the phone, he stood walking around the desk and wrapping his arms around me. Why aren't you in bed, baby girl? How are you feeling? I feel okay. You know I have a high pain tolerance. How did you get here? I was going to come by and see you when I left here. Christina, she took me to go get a phone, then she dropped me off here. Why didn't your husband take you? I'm staying with Christina for the time being. Why? I paused, trying to choose my words carefully. Kamani and I are not seeing eye to eye right now. I need to be away from him. You were just away from him for what seemed like forever. What's going on, baby girl? And what's this I hear from the agent that you're not talking to him? What is up with that? I pushed a few strands of hair behind my ear while looking at the floor. There's nothing to talk about. What do you mean there's nothing to talk about? You were fucking kidnapped, Urvi. People were asking for a $20 million ransom. They claim to have cut your finger off. There is so much to talk about that your mouth should be extremely dry from talking right now. I didn't respond. So it's true? He sat back in his seat. Oh my God. He raised his fist to his mouth. You and Kamani cooked this fucking shit up to get money? What? No! Who would say that? It's hard not to say that when you're not cooperating with the police. It leaves a very bad taste in people's mouths. I mean, does that make sense to you? I'm asking. I'm not trying to come down on you. Not only are you not cooperating with the police, but you're also not even under the same roof as him. What's going on? I didn't say anything. Urvi, he slammed his fist down on the table. Did you and Mom have money problems? I blurted out. Even with all that was going on, my dad borrowing money from Duke was in the back of my mind. I worked my ass off to get their numbers way up in the black, so there was no reason why he should have been borrowing money from Duke. He sat up in his seat. What are you talking about? No, your mother and I have never had money problems. Why would you ask that? I bit the inside of my cheek. There was really no other way to ease my dad into the conversation I wanted to have with him. If Kamani had gotten a woman pregnant and tried to get rid of her, I could only imagine the reason why my dad got money from him. Have you cheated on Mom? His eyes widened before he cocked his head to the side. Before you were born, we've also had several rough patches where we've called ourselves separating only for us to end up back together. But all of that was long ago. Why are you asking me that? Have you gotten any of those women pregnant? Urvi, your mother is the only woman that I have ever gotten pregnant. Where is this line of questioning coming from? I didn't say anything. Urvi Valentine, you borrowed money from... I paused because I couldn't believe that I was asking my father this. Moments later, he said, oh my fucking Urvi. No, 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 no. He put it all together. That motherfucker, that's who the fuck had you? Why the fuck you're not telling the cops who the fuck had you? My dad picked up his desk phone, prompting me to jump up and press the button to end the call. What are you doing? Dad, why did you borrow money from him? What did he say? He growled. He didn't say anything. That's why I'm here talking to you. He shook his head. I'm calling Dean. No, you can't. I'm home now. That's all that matters. Stop deflecting and tell me why you borrowed money from him. You're protecting him. He shot you and you're protecting him. He didn't shoot me, Dad. Who did? I kept quiet and looked at the floor. Why are you protecting him? I kept my lips pressed together. Oh, my God. Whatever you're thinking in your head, you can get it right out the hell, right the hell out now, because that'll never happen over my dead body, Urvi. It's not your decision. Tell me why you borrowed money from him. Urvi, I am so fucking mad right now. I can't even fucking look at you right now. Well, I stood up. When you can stand to look at me, get in contact with me. When I turned and headed for the door, he called out to me. Urvi. I turned around. Yeah? Have a seat, he sighed. When I sat down, he stared at me for a few moments. You know how special your mother is to me, right? Yes, she's only tatted on you 100 times with 1,000,000 pictures around your office, and you talk about her nonstop. Even when she doesn't deserve anyone's love, you give it to her. He swallowed before looking at the picture of them on his desk. You remember when you were in college and your mother and sister and brother got into that car accident when she picked them up from school? Yeah, I remember. She was drunk, nearly killed herself and her kids. I remember. Somehow, she didn't go to jail for the DUI. So I'm assuming that's why you borrowed money from Ananias, so you could make the DUI go away. He shook his head. Dad, spit it out. When your mother hit her head, as the doctor explained, triggered a hypersexual something in her brain, and it caused her to be very... you know, sexual. I mean, at first, it was cool. My wife wanted to fuck me every day, sometimes 3 times a day, and it was beautiful. She wanted it too damn much. I told her no one time, and she disappeared for 2 days doing God knows what or with who. During those 2 days she was gone, she'd spent $75,000. When she came home, it was like she didn't do anything wrong. She even seemed normal. Weeks go by, and she goes back to fucking me like crazy. I turned her down, and she left again. After her second time abandoning us, we went to the doctor to let him know what was going on, and that's when he said the accident caused her hypersexual shit. Not her hypersexual shit. A whole bunch of big words came out of his mouth regarding her brain. She didn't believe anything they said, and we left the doctor's office. He sat back in his seat. His jaws were clenched. Water started to fill his eyes. Dad, I whispered. This went on for months, close to a year. When I turned her down for sex, she'd leave and not come back for days at a time. She'd go and spend thousands of dollars at a time, anywhere. A part of me wanted to hire a PI, but did I really want to know that my wife was losing her mind? I begged her to get counseling. I even told her that I'd go to counseling with her. Meetings, whatever. But she didn't believe she had a problem. It wasn't until I told her I was going to divorce her if she didn't get the help she needed. She left the house, and several days went by, and I didn't hear from her. Normally, she'd come home after a two-day binge on God knows what, but after not hearing from her for 4 days, I got worried and went out to look for her. I couldn't find her. I was about to break down and call the police when I started getting emails about my cards being used for large amounts of money. At that point, I was thankful that she was alive. But when I started calling around to the businesses, they were saying they hadn't seen my wife, which meant someone else had my card. So I started combing through hospitals, and I finally found her listed as a Jane Doe. I gasped. What, Dad? Why didn't you say anything? She was beaten and raped. Badly. When she finally woke up, she admitted that she needed help and wanted to go to rehab to help her urges and that she'd take her medicine. I thought things would be great after that, but the video of her rape got sent to my phone. I went to Duke to make sure that the video never saw the light of day and that those niggas paid for what they did to my fucking wife. He did his job, Urvi. Saved you, our family, your mother, and our business the scrutiny. Tears slipped from my eyes. Why didn't you say anything? How did this happen, Dad? I started to sob. You didn't need to be worried about that. Your sister and brother didn't need to know that. As far as they are concerned, your mother went to rehab for alcohol and she just relapsed and hasn't gone back since. How did I miss this? I mean, I remembered when you said Mom went to rehab, but that was the end of it. It was easy to miss because you and your mother's relationship isn't all that good. Wow. Even though he did me a great favor, I still forbid you from seeing him ever again, Urvi. You are 29 years old, and I've always let you make your own mistakes. But this one person that I will never, ever agree to you seeing. I stood up. Dad, it's not your decision. Urvi, please. Duke is a dangerous man. Indeed. We like him dangerous. Sorry. You don't feel anything for him. You're just traumatized. Maybe I am. Maybe I'm not. Either way, seeing him again will be my decision and my decision alone. Was I really traumatized? And that's the end of that chapter. Ooh, y'all. Ooh, she gonna go see him and they gonna get to getting, slapping skin, squirting and stuff. Yes. I'm sorry. I'm a little bit too excited. Hey, Denny. Good evening. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. Child, you missed it. I shouted you out and your podcast. Told everybody to go listen. Okay? Yes, indeed. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you are here. Ain't been no sex yet, so you ain't missed nothing, child. We all mad about it. Everybody threatening to shut the speakeasy down because it ain't been no skin slapping yet. I mean, I'm a little disappointed, but good googly moogly. Oh, my goodness. Child, we done read all these pages and ain't nobody had no skin slapped or nothing. I'm like, it ain't even been a little bit of a choke out or nothing. I'm just like, what a girl got to do to get a spanky spank? Something. Oh, Lord have mercy. It's all right, though. Hold on, y'all. Let's get ready for this. I think, oh, my God, it is lightning so bad, y'all. I really, I'm nervous. You hear all that? Mm-hmm. And I told you. And there you go. I don't care. It's 8:30. I don't care. You're missing the point. It's storming outside, young man. Oh, I'm sorry, y'all. Ooh. Can y'all hear that? Can y'all hear that thunderclap? That's thunder, y'all. Oh, my God. Did y'all hear it? I think I better stop, y'all, because the lights are flashing. Denny said, is the book scale back? No, we got to get through the fool la la. Yes, that was thunder, child. I'm sitting in the kitchen about to wet my underwear, and not in a good way. Oh, my God. Yes, child. Listen, Linda, it is pouring cats and dogs, roaches and rats and rabbits and all kinds of shit out. Oh my God. Listen, when I was little, I used to say the clouds are peeing everywhere. Oh my God. Listen. Oh my goodness. This is insane, y'all. I think I better stop because the lights are flashing like crazy and I don't want it to stop in the middle of the you dig and then we be sitting up here looking crazy. Lord have mercy. Ooh, I can't stand it, child. Listen, I know, right? I know. Didn't it sound like furniture moving? Wait a minute. She talking about, no, don't stop. Keep going. Listen, that's what I told him. Sorry. Listen. Oh, my God. Oh, my God, y'all. I'm so scared. I'm nervous. Because lightning is flashing across the sky. I used to say, it's thunder men, lightning men. Oh, my God. Oh, my goodness. Y'all. Oh, please stop it with the storm. All right, let me, I'm gonna do one more, child. I don't even know how long this chapter is, but we finally get to hear from Duke again. And I really want to see, let me see how long this is. Oh, I'm so scared. We know it ain't going to be no sexy smexy. We going to read it anyway, child. Child, they both here looking at me crazy because I've been begging for a generator. It's been storming all day. Insane in the membrane. Lord have mercy. All right, let's do this one little thing, y'all, and then I'm out of here. Ooh. This is insane. All right, as soon as we get to the 30-second mark, hold on, we... Lordy. Duke. My lawyer paced in front of my desk while his two sons ran amok over my office. I had just explained to him everything that had gone down when I kidnapped Urvi, from my brother shooting her to being home from the hospital. I told him that I didn't think Urvi would speak because she would have been said something and the FBI would have been approached me. It had been 4 days since she left, my steps dripping in blood. You can't catch me. You can't catch me, one of the kids teased. Rick Princeton, enough. Sit down. Preston ordered them, but they ignored him. They're fine, I told them. Preston stopped pacing and looked at me. But you're not. You're not fine. You call me here to tell me that you and your brother, he leaned over my desk, freaking kidnapped and shot the governor's wife. Are you crazy? You're sitting here all nonchalant like this woman cannot end your life. Preston, one, step back or sit down. I don't like for any man to stand over me. Two, I would like for you to calm down so you can do what I pay you to do, and that's think better than me. I told you that she wouldn't talk. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But you don't know that, though. You said she loves you, but when the shock wears off, you never know what you're going to get. She might say something when she comes to the realization that she was fucking shot. Ooh, Dad said a bad word. Sorry, little Rick. You're acting erratic. Are you okay? He flopped down in the seat and pull the chair closer to the desk. You are the first person to ask me if I'm okay. Thank you for asking. No, I'm not okay. Do not have kids. Hold on, y'all. I gotta change these headphones. Good Google. Always something. I looked at the wide-eyed boys. Preston, the boys are not a bother to me. It's not the boys, it's the girl. The girls, rather. My daughter came on her period a few days ago, and she's barely 12 years old. Barely. She's going to be in middle school when school starts, and I can't think straight right now. My wife decided that she wanted, no, needed, as she explained, to take her and several of her friends for a period moon, a period party, or something like that. I don't goddamn know, Duke, why my wife decided that the period party needed to be at a $1,700 a night suite on the beach in Miami. I don't know. One second. Okay. I don't know the answer to that either, Duke, but here we are. So they're going to be gone for a full week. So you do the math. Four 12-year-old girls on the beach in Miami, shopping and eating, eating and shopping. So far, my card has been swiped for $20,000. So in sum, it's cost me $20,000 because of a period. The icing on the cake is that while I'm home stressing about my daughter being able to get pregnant now, my client decided that he was going to kidnap a woman, leave me, his lawyer, out of it, and then just call me to his office to tell me this, nonchalantly. He put his head down on my desk. Dad, I have to pee. Me too, Dad. All right, come on. He took them in my personal bathroom. I couldn't help but to think about my life and how much it would alter if I had children. Watching Preston be stressed out about his daughter kind of made me look forward to having a daughter, or even a couple of sons. I'm sure they kept him on his toes. About 5 minutes later, they came out of the bathroom and went right back to playing. So, now that I've gotten my dad woes off my chest, we're going to sit tight until your name comes up. But thanks for so graciously letting me in on what's going on. Preston, what would you do without me as a client? Be rich, but with less stress. Meanwhile, stay away from that girl until everything blows over. That's not part of the deal, Preston. I'll be seeing her. Okay, do whatever you want to do, Duke. I was going to do that anyway. He chuckled while shaking his head. Boys, it's time to go. Say bye to Mr. Duke. Bye, Mr. Duke. They sang out in unison before they ran out of the open door and into the lobby area. Boys, slow down. He looked back at me. Can you manage to not, you know, kidnap someone else before we can get this behind us? I'll do my best. He shook his head before letting the door close. I went over to my bar and poured myself a couple splashes of whiskey before walking over to the window and staring down at the many people walking around. After seeing how my lawyer was with his children, I wondered how I would be with mine. Would I be like my father or grandfather? Most times, you heard people say how they would be as parents, and then the shit changed completely when the kids came. Well, I wondered how Irby's little ass would look pregnant. In my eyes, she was a tiny little something, so I wondered how her body would look carrying my seed. Hell, I had all these damn thoughts, and I didn't even know if she felt the same way about me as I felt about her. Mm-hmm. Somebody in love, y'all. My brother, dear shooter, he'd been trying to get back in my good graces since the night of the shooting, but I wasn't ready to forgive him just yet. He didn't understand how his temper could lead to the death of him one day. The door came open. Mr. Duke, Agent Dean in the lobby, wanted to speak to you. Is it okay to let him back? I kept my back to her. Sure, let him back. Do I need to call Preston? No. Okay, I'll send him back. Thank you. Moments later, I heard, Mr. Ananias Duke, nice office you got here. Switch things up a bit since the last time I was here. I'll give my interior designer a ring and let her know. I just want to chat. As friends, of course. It's been a while. Turning around, I gave him a tight-lipped smile before walking over to my desk and sitting down. I would offer you a seat, but that means you'll stay longer than I intend for you to stay. How can AD Enterprises be of service for you today? He eyed my neck bandage before eyeing me. Interesting bandage you got on your neck. You wouldn't have happened to get that scar a few days ago, would you? I shook my head from side to side as if I was confused. Give or take, I can't remember. You didn't come here to talk about scars, and I really didn't have time for unscheduled appointments today. He smiled. You know I know, right? Know what? It was you that had the governor's wife kidnapped. See, I put it all together. Ooh, I like the sound of that. Run it down for me, Nancy Drew. The governor and his wife showed up at your party on Saturday, and if I'm thinking correctly, your pickup days are on Monday. If Kamani and his wife went out of town on Monday evening, and Urvi got kidnapped Monday night, then that makes sense for your schedule. He eased in the seat. But what I can't figure out is why she's still alive. You don't normally leave your victims alive, and for so long. Are you turning over a new lease on life? I sat back in my seat and gave him a miniature applause. Agent Dean was one of those uppity-ass niggas that always wanted to be the smartest man in the room. He always thought he knew everything. I passed across more than a few times. Every time they did, he always made sure to remind me that one day I'd slip up and he'd be so proud to arrest me. Why did you leave Urvi alive? What was it about her? Did she put that pussy on you or something? Did you fall in love with her? I mean, one could see how you would, though. She looks like she has a tight little pussy and her little pouty lips. Very suckable. And would probably look good wrapped around my... Mr. Duke, was that an eye twitch? He reached into his pocket, pulled out a notepad, and flipped it open while keeping his eyes on me. He unclipped the pen from his jacket pocket and started to write. Right eye twitches when he's rattled. He mumbled while scribbling on the piece of paper. He stood up, as you know. Eventually, they talk. They always talk, Mr. Duke. And as I always tell you when you leave my office with less than what you came with, good luck, Agent Dean. This time your money is not going to make this go away. I can't be bought, Mr. Duke. It was my turn to stand and smile. Every time we speak, you're always insinuating that I am a slave master. Where did you hear that from? Why is it that you think I'm in the business of slave trade? I don't buy or sell people. If I didn't know any better, I'd say you had a price. You may have over 50% of the police on your payroll, but you can't fool me. The next time you see me, I'll be dragging your ass out of here in handcuffs. Good day, Agent Dean. On your way out, tell my assistant to call down to the bottom desk and put you on the list of people that can't get past security. Thank you. It's only a matter of time. I said good day, Agent Dean. I didn't sit down until he was out of my office. I'd always considered myself to be a good reader of people, and his vibe always gave me hard to get in the sense that it took more than a few dollars to get him to look away on some shit. So I never bothered to try and get him on my payroll. Eventually, he'd come around. They always did. As the sunset started to peek into my window, I started shutting my computer down because I was calling it a day. I needed to go home and take a long, cold-ass shower. I missed her, and I hated that I did. For the last couple of days, I'd been hovering my finger over the button to call Angel to send a girl over and relieve some stress and tension, but I'd backed out. When I stood up, I grabbed my jacket and threw it on. Sir, 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 you cannot go back there. I looked up just in time to see Miko rushing into my office. You son of a bitch, you had my daughter the whole fucking time while I stood here begging your ass for some money. I opened the drawer and pulled my pistol out of it, setting it on the desk. Miko, I strongly advise you to calm down. Strongly. You don't have to go back down the elevator with a heartbeat. You understand where I'm going with this? You shot my fucking daughter. Where is this information coming from? Looking past him, both John and Vincent came rushing into my office, grabbing Miko up by each of his arms. His feet were off the ground. Boss, what do you want us to do with him? I waved them off. The man is worried about his daughter. Let him down. He snatched away from them as soon as they let him down, as if he'd done something. You better stay the fuck away from my daughter, he spoke through gritted teeth. Or what? There isn't no or what. You come near her again and there has to be an or what, Miko. You don't come in here throwing around threats and not give me a consequence. I'm going to need one because I'm going to see your daughter again. I need to know what I need to be on the lookout for. Just when he was getting ready to lunge at me, Vincent and John grabbed him again. It doesn't matter anyway. My Val is smart. She would never see a man like you. Trust me. I know my baby. You are not her type. I raised my eyebrow in response to that while smirking. He didn't know his baby girl like he thought he did. I threw my head back slightly, giving them the okay to take his ass out of my office. I'll see you later, pops. Duke's asshole. Listen, Vincent and John dragged him out of my office. I locked up my office and left. What time you getting out of here, Steph? I have a few more things to do and I'll be right out. Okay, How's that other thing going? You know what I asked you to do a couple of weeks ago? Ah, yes. She and her daughter have moved in safely. She's in the process of picking out a school now. I told her to call me when she narrows it down to three schools so we can get it worked out. Good. Steph smiled. Mr. Duke, you did a good thing. I nodded my head before leaving. Ever since Urvi told me about her young friend at the shelter, Chanel, she'd been on my mind. Since I only had her first name, it took a few days to find her. I had Steph go and talk to her about getting her own living space with her daughter and free childcare while she furthered her education for free with a monthly stipend of $1,500 to do whatever she wanted to do with it. As long as she wasn't fucking up, she'd never hear from me or Steph. She didn't believe that Steph would do that for free. It took her a few days to process it, but she finally reached out to Steph. She was living in one of my corporate apartments for the time being until she figured out what school she wanted to go to. Whatever college she wanted to go, I'd find her a place there because she didn't have a driver's license and I wasn't about to get her a car. It actually felt pretty good to help her out like that. Where to? John asked. Let's go to Christina's house. That's where she's been staying. I rattled off her address to him. He nodded his head. I'd heard from a little birdie that she'd been staying with her friend. When I pulled my vibrating phone out of my pocket, I saw that it was Paul calling, but I rejected his phone call. I'd been rejecting his and Amos's calls because I was still upset at both of them. Amos still stood by him. That shooting Urvi was the right thing to do. Paul refused to take accountability that he was the reason she was shot. If he and Amos hadn't been at my home, Urvi wouldn't have been shot. My father tried to get me to see both sides, and I did. They were just trying to protect me, and I understood that. But it was the fact that they shouldn't have been in my home to begin with. How could Amos think that telling Urvi that Naomi was the only girl for me would somehow protect me? That was the part that really pissed me off, honestly. 30 minutes later, we pulled into a new subdivision. It didn't take long for us to find the house that belonged to Christina. There wasn't a car outside, but the garage door was down. The house was dark, so I wondered if she was inside. There was only one way to find out. You want me and Vince to wait outside? Yeah, I'm cool. If you hear gunshots, you can come in. He chuckled. Stepping out of the truck, I walked up the sidewalk and tapped the doorbell a couple of times. Moments later, the porch light came on. The door swung open, and Urvi stood there with a shocked look on her face. Her arm was in a sling, and there were bandages and a few spots on her arm and one on her ear. Aside from that, she was still absolutely beautiful to me. Ananias, Urvi, are you alone? She nodded her head. Is it okay if I come in? She moved out of the way and let me walk in. When I walked in, she closed and locked the door behind me. She led me down the hall into the sitting area. It was dark in the room. The only light in the room came from the large flat screen on the wall. She turned the light on and offered me a seat. How are you feeling? I don't feel how I look. I reached out and touched the bandage on my neck. I'm sorry I hurt you. It's okay. It was just a graze. Nothing a few stitches couldn't fix. Oh, are you here to tell me not to talk to the FBI? That agent man keeps trying to get me to talk to him. What do you want to do? I wasn't expecting her to shrug her shoulders. I don't want to get you in trouble. I mean, I did shoot you too. I was acting very erratic, Ananias, but what I heard wasn't pretty either. Is this fake? None of it was fake, Urvi. None of it. But she stopped when I ran my fingers down her neck before gripping it and bringing her closer to me. I pressed my lips against hers, keeping my eyes on her. Her eyes lowered and she deepened the kiss. Grabbing her hand, I placed it on my hard dick. Nothing about that is fake, Urvi. I miss you. I whispered against her lips, prompting her to pull away from me. You are a man. Your dick'll get hard from any type of touch. Urvi. No, she hissed. Right before your brother and grandfather barged in on us, I told you something. Well, I kind of asked you something. Do you remember what it was? How could I forget, Urvi? You asked me if it was possible to love someone and you didn't know them. And I responded by saying anything is possible. She nodded her head. And what did that mean, Ananias? Did that mean that you feel the same way about me? I bit the inside of my lip. I don't know what it means. What I know is that for the last 4 days, a nigga has been struggling, waking up and not going out to the guest house to feed you. Or even that last time when you woke up under me wanting dick. I knew how sexy you looked laying in that bed as I got ready for work. It felt like something I could do for a long time. When I came home from work to see you in my clothes watching TV, I felt like I could come home and see you like that a lot. Every time I thought about you possibly leaving and being gone when I got home, it made my heart skip several beats. Shit is weird, Urvi. That's what I feel. All of that. She chuckled. You sure it's not the pain meds talking? You know I'm not taking any pain meds. Okay, You say you feel all of that, but what does that mean for us? No, your family hates me. Your grandfather and brother said some pretty awful things about me, Ananias. You didn't say anything to protect me. How can I trust that? I can't. She started to cry. Please don't cry. I can't handle that. She rested her head on my shoulder. Can I kiss you, baby? She nodded her head against my shoulder. Oh, he wanted to kiss her. Oh, my God. Oh, wait a minute. Listen. Just stop making me choke, Danny. You wait, that sounded wrong. No, God. What I'm saying is, you with the snow roaches, hush, child. Okay. Okay. She turned her head toward me and angled it upward toward my face. I placed a couple of kisses on her forehead before kissing her nose. She moved back a little before placing her lips on mine. She'd snaked her tongue in my mouth and I sucked on it. She'd started rubbing her hand up and down my crotch. When we heard the gasp at the door, she moved away from me. She walked further into the room. Val, what the fuck is he doing in my home? You gave him my fucking address? Before she could respond, I stood and walked toward her. Duke, I know who you are. Get out. In her defense, she did not give me your address. Out. Urvi got up and walked up behind me. I'll walk you out. When we got to the front door, she opened it and I stepped outside and turned around. Where do we go from here? I just need some time. I'm not going to say anything to them if that's what you're worried about. I'm not. I'm worried about you, baby. Looking past her, I saw that Christina stood at the end of the hallway with her hands on her hips. She looked upset. You don't have to. I'm a big girl. I'll call you. You don't have my number. She smiled. Can I just Google AD Enterprises and get Steph to connect me to you? Yes. Yes, you can. I'll stop whatever I'm doing to get the phone. Even if it means you miss out on money? I wrapped my arm around her waist and pulled her to me. Even if it means I miss out on money. Ooh, she whispered. Yeah. He misses you like crazy. Don't make him wait too long. I promise I'll call. What am I supposed to do in the meantime? Do what Ananias Duke is good at doing. Making money. Spending money. With my other hand, I gripped her chin and pressed my lips against hers softly. The slight whimper that came from her lips nearly made me come on myself. Urvi, I will come after you, okay? Take all the time you need, but I will not let you get away from me this easy. Do you understand? If I have to fight for you, I will. If I have to do what I do best to get you to that estate, then I'll do it. She smiled before I kissed her again. As soon as I snaked my tongue in her mouth, Christina cleared her throat. Urvi, Christina yelled. She pecked my lips a couple more times before moving out of my grasp. Good night, Ananias. Good night, Urvi. Her friend need to go on somewhere, okay? Girl, stop being a fucking hater. I stood in the same spot until the door closed. Before I could get down the sidewalk, I heard Christina yelling at her. All that told me was I was going to work extra hard to get her back in my life because if I hadn't learned anything about her over the last few weeks, I knew that she loved her best friend and father to death. If two of the most important people in her life were telling her the same thing, I knew that she would listen. Damn, man. I'm so fucking mad. And that's the end of that chapter, y'all. Listen, Linda. I am so mad, y'all. Ooh, I don't even want to hear from her bitch ass husband, Kamani, because you know what? He could fall down the stairs and break his entire damn spine. Okay. I just want the whole thing to just crack like Christmas pecans. Oh, he is annoying as fuck. And I bet you he gonna try to R-word her too. He gonna try to kidnap her and R-word her. He is dookie. I'm telling y'all. Y'all don't even realize. I'm trying to get, oh, God. Let me see. I don't even know. I wanted Duke to just pick her ass up and just take her right on back to the manor, honey. And just anybody ever watch that show back in the day, Makeover Manor? I love that show. That was a long time ago, though. Let me see. I'm trying to you don't come on no more. But that was a good ass show. All right. Y'all can hang it up. It's 9 o'clock. I'm going to stop right here. And yeah, because at this point, I don't want to tempt the gods, okay, with this rain and this damn lightning shooting across the sky. Like, which one is the god of lightning? I throw a thunder, right? Zeus is the lightning rod, right? Like, Zeus and Thor is out there having a war. I can make it louder. I can make it louder. It's insane outside right now. And I don't want to risk it for the biscuit, okay? No God, because I would be so embarrassed if the lights go out and I couldn't say goodbye to y'all. Yeah, child, listen. I don't keep up with that. I got my own Duke over here. I got to make thunder and lightning. Watch out there now. Anyway. Stay out of my business, Marva. Marva, always in my business. Saki, what you doing? Anyway. All right, y'all. Listen, I will come back tomorrow. Y'all know I will. And we'll pick up where we left off, child. Because this turd of a husband of hers is the next chapter, child. I want him to go away. Like, whoa, why don't they arrest him for all the shit that he done did? So, yeah. Anyway. All right. I love y'all. Thank y'all for coming over here listening to me read out loud. This was fun. It's always so much fun in the speakeasy. We have a good time over here, y'all. I be reading and talking shit, and y'all be cheering me on in the stands. A good time, and y'all know I be hating to leave y'all, okay? So listen. Y'all go forth and have a great night and be glad it ain't raining in your neck of the woods, child, because this shit is no joke out here today. I don't understand it. It's been raining all day. It literally has been raining all day. So, all right, y'all be good. All right. Yes. And thank you, Denny. Again, y'all, go over there to Spotify and subscribe to or follow Digi Denny presents the Walk and Talk podcast, all right, by our own sipper and speaker and Snow Roach Stomper, Digi Denny. I'm going to Oh my God. Listen, Linda. Yes, look at this one with this mess. No, ma'am. Not today. Okay, but y'all be safe, okay? I love y'all, okay? And I want y'all to make sure y'all come back tomorrow. I'll make sure that I put the thing out there early enough for y'all, and I'll read y'all through y'all little work day because we got to finish this, okay? All right, y'all take care, and if you do nothing else, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Until next time, Denny, I'll get you with the snow roach. I'm dead. My sippers and speakers are so bad. I love it. All right, y'all. Until next time, bye, y'all.